Hey, this is John Mashey. I'm a trustee at the Computer History Museum. It's my pleasure to interview Ken Thompson about his involvement with computer chess over the years. So, Ken, welcome to the museum.
Oh, thank you very much. Thanks for inviting me.
Oh, sure. So, let's start at the beginning. Where are you from? Where did you go to school? And how much game playing did you do before you got to college?
Oh, going way back.
Yes, all the way.
My father was military, and the technical term for that is Navy brat. So I was a Navy brat for the first 20 years of my life, and we moved all over. I never spent more than a year or two in any one place. So that was high school, and then I graduated high school in Chula Vista, California, and went to school in Berkeley. That's essentially my educational career.
Okay. So in high school or before or in college, what sort of involvement with games did you have, whether chess or other games?
I was always interested in games. I read game books and crosswords, things like that. Chess in particular, I took up kind of the year that Bobby Fischer was mopping up in the U.S. when he was, he's about 1 month different age than I. And, you know, you get this feeling that, you know, why aren't you any good? You know, he's on the cover of Look magazine, you know, at 14, and I'm going to school in Texas. So, my parents played bridge, and the whole family actually played bridge. I played bridge a lot. Never liked the game, and they would take me to this hotel once a week where they played duplicate bridge. In this little town in Texas. And there were a couple of old men there that played chess in the lobby. And when I didn't play bridge, I'd go and watch them play chess. And eventually I started playing, and then I read a couple of books on it with all the Bobby Fischer, you know, hullabaloo going on. And then I played for about 6 months like on the team in school. This is, I believe it was seventh grade, might have been sixth grade. And I guess nobody in sixth grade ever read a chess book before, because as soon as you read a chess book, you're better than everybody else. and then I quit it, and essentially never played after that. I was always a fan of chess, always followed it, always read the games, read the books, followed the tournaments. But after that sixth or seventh grade, I never played personally.
Okay, so how about other games? Any other ones that you were interested in before college?
I was interested in college. Mm-hmm. I was interested in three-dimensional tic-tac-toe, 4x4x4, and I had a gamer for a teacher, Berlikamp, very, very nice man. And I used to get midnight computer time, basically. When it was idle, I'd go in and take over the machine.
What machine was this?
7094.
Oh, 7094, okay.
And I wrote some game-playing programs, one of them being 3D tic-tac-toe. And Berlikamp is still the strongest person I've ever known at that game. And I used to, and you know, wake him up in the middle of the night, like 2 a.m, and he'd come out to the computer room and play this game with me and beat it, you know, and I'd go lick my wounds, go back and try to do better. But that's that. I did that. Also, there was a game called Bridget, which is an N by N array, where N can be, you know, somewhere around 19, 20, something like that. And one player connects, you know, red lines on this screen, and the other player connects blue lines. And the red player tries to connect the bottom row, you know, wiggling up to the top row. And the blue player tries to block and connect left to right or right to left. And the first person to make a connection wins. And again, there were some people at school that were very, very good at this, and this was my first game at cheating. Basically, the screens in those days were kind of round, and they kind of bulged, And at one point I had an idea, I couldn't beat this guy, so I made it 19 by 18. Which is, it is a real advantage, especially if you go first. and he didn't notice, and he actually got beat a couple times before he figured out that the screen wasn't square.
I think that's a little harder to get away with that in a competitive chess. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So
7x8 board.
Yes. Yeah. So then, how did you end up at Bell Labs?
My teachers recommended me. I wasn't looking for a job. I was just hanging around. I was having a good time. I kind of almost ran the school. You know, as far as computers go, I was into every nook and corner. And they sicked a Bell Labs recruiter on me, who tried to get me down for an interview the entire week he was there. And finally, on the last night before he was going home, he called me at home and came over to my house to interview me, and disappeared. Then I got a letter inviting me for an interview on the East Coast. And I had a lot of old friends that were spread all over the U.S. Mm-hmm. from the mm-hmm. Navy brat kind of days. And so I told them, you know, that you know, I wasn't interested in a job, but I'd take their interview just to, you know, get a free ride to the East Coast to visit some of my friends. And they said, anything you want, you know, it's fine. And went to the East Coast. I interviewed 2 days out there, one day at Whippany, one day at Murray Hill. Whippany was grim. And Murray Hill, there were actually two departments that looked very good. And when I got home, there was a letter saying, you know, if you want a job, you can have it. Just rank the departments in order. And I thought about it for a week or so and then ranked them, sent them in, and I got offers from the top two that I'd ranked. And thought about that for another couple of weeks and said, okay.
Okay. Well, an interesting testament to the persistence of that recruiter, yes. Okay, so anyway, you moved to Bell Labs, and when was that?
66.
66, right. Okay. And what did you start doing when you were there?
I was hired to work on Multics.
And Multics, yeah.
And you know, it was just a big, monstrous project with GE, Bell Labs, and MIT to build the time-sharing system that was going to end all time-sharing systems. And it was hugely over-designed and wildly uneconomical. It had very unique hardware. It was a research project on about four fronts, when, you know, any good research project should only have one front. Bell Labs quit the project when it decided that it was wasn't going to satisfy their needs, and then I was almost like out of a job at that point. I kind of had these old Multics computers lying around before they disappeared, and no real thing to do. So I just did what I wanted to do from then on,
which was
games and operating systems, and I don't know, anything that crossed my mind. I did some positional astronomy, some audio, anything, absolutely anything that I wanted to do.
Well, so we were looking at the DEC PDP-1 in Space War. All right. So talk about that. I guess that was one of your first applications on minicomputers, as I recall.
Well, PDP-1, the only PDP-1 I ever programmed or had access to was at Stanford when I was at school in Berkeley. That Stanford and Berkeley had co-op arrangements. And at some point we were moving out our 7090 for a 7094, and we had no computer for an extended period. And we got Stanford to loan us their 7090 and 7094 at night. So I'd come down to Stanford at night with jobs to run and stuff like that, and take the stuff back in the morning. This is like, you know, midnight to 8. And in the computer center there was their PDB-1, and I played a lot. So that was my only actual contact with the PDP-1 and the real space war. After that, Dennis Ritchie and I found a PDP-7 with a 340 display, the roughly the same display.
What kind of display is that?
It's a vector display. Okay. It'll move to and draw lines, and it runs a vector list. The display runs an instruction list that says draw this, draw this, draw this, and at the bottom, it'll stop, and then you wait a 60th of a cycle and start it again at the top. One of the games we wrote for that was Space War. We pulled up various copies of it and then copied it over, made it, run on the PDP-7, and got it running. It was, always very popular. And then I did a bunch of other programs like it. There was a three-dimensional space where this machine, this PDP-7, was a remote job entry station for circuit analysis. And it had a real high-speed data set. It had a 2,000 baud data set on it that was used to send the real computation task to big central computer. Well, there were several of these satellite computers around, and we'd have them call each other up and exchange coordinates, game coordinates, and you could play somebody else on some other computer. And this computer had a big hood that you could put over the screen that would that was partitioned so that one eye saw half the screen and one eye saw the other half of the screen. And so I wrote a three-dimensional space game where you'd travel around in a cube and find the other guy who was on the other machine doing the same thing and, shoot him and kill him. All the games are shoot and kill.
Yeah, yeah.
So I did some of that, and then there was a simulation of the solar system that I did.
This is the space travel game?
This is space travel.
Yeah. Okay.
That you would take off and move, go to someplace else. You'd go into orbit around something, dock with something, those kind of things. Had all the solar system objects that it was two-dimensional, it wasn't three, that we knew and loved then. They're more now, of course, but anyway, that was a fun game, and that got us into the PDP-7, into really running it. And then on the PDP-7, we wrote the first version of Unix.
Sure, of course, yeah. Now, was there any chess on that?
There was an MIT chess program that you could just load standalone and then play. And I played maybe one or two games of it. I think it was a variety of the Kotak.
Okay.
But I'm not that sure what its origination was. But it did come from MIT for the PDP-7.
Okay. So then there was a move over to the PDP-11, right? Someplace in there.
Yes. We bought a PDP-11. The excuse was text processing, but the real thing was to play more, to play.
Yeah, right. And as I recall this, once upon a time, weren't you trying to get a PDP-10 or something like that for the lab?
Yes, we were arguing that the Multics machine should be replaced with a PDP-10, and there was such a huge backlash from Multics that it was pretty soundly turned down. Mm-hmm. It was probably a good idea. It was the 10 is kind of a trashy machine, 36 bits. The future just left it behind.
Yeah.
Yeah,
the world would have been a little different, perhaps, had that happened. Okay, but in any case, you got off onto PDP-11s. When did the sort of chess emphasis get restarted in your mind there, when did you start getting serious writing chess software on that?
There was a display on the first PDP-7, I wrote a set of display programs. and then that moved on to the 11. And they were just kind of parlor games to increase, you know, interest in it. I wrote a pool program where you, you know, line up and shoot pool balls, and they'd strike and break and bounce over the screen. And I wrote a chess program. And the chess program was actually, I took it out and actually competed it a couple times. I took it to the New Jersey Open in about 72 or 3, and won one game and drew a couple games and lost the rest. It was a very, very weak program, and it was then distributed on the first versions of Unix as chess.
It was chess.
Yes. Okay. I did a better job of it in software and took it to the big national chess tournament. There were two sets of chess tournaments going on in those days. One was American, which was run by the ACM, and it was routinely called either the ACM Chess Championships, the U.S. Chess Championships, Computer Chess Championships, or the North American Computer Chess Championships as it got broader. And it ran every year, and it was typically at the ACM conference. And then there was one every 3 years, which was called the World Championship. And that was actually weaker. It had a bigger title, but it was weaker because they would try to not keep it dominated by the U.S. teams, and they'd throw out the bottom of the U.S. teams and invite essentially everybody else in the world. And that actually weakened the pot. And then that was run every 3 years.
So in that era, could you sort of talk about the competition and the general caliber of play? What sorts of things could the programs do at that point?
I think they played well. They were probably, when I started, my program was probably 1,200.
And oh, so you might want to explain that a little bit.
Okay.
Talk about USCF ratings and
The ratings are where one sigma is 100, is 200 points. And the classes are every 200 points, they draw a line and they say the class. And if you and I play and I beat you a lot, then I steal some of your points. And if you beat me, you steal some of my points. So this is kind of a big point pool. Called the ELO rating system of all the chess players in the United States and also other places too, not just the United States. It was originally designed that 1,500 is the average tournament chess player. And then if you're good, you go like to 1,800, that's class A, 2,000 is expert, 2,200 is master, 2,400 senior master, 2,600 is grandmaster, roughly. So that's every 200 points, and then below, 18 and below is like 18-16 is A, 16-14 is B, 14-12 is C. So this was low C, quite a bit below average for chess players. If you play at home with your parents or your friends quite a lot and you go to a real tournament, you'll probably end up around 1,200 or 1,300. Okay. If you play tournaments for a lot and are kind of average, you don't actually study it, but you know, you play a lot, you go once a week to a tournament, then you'll be 1,500. And then if you show real talent and start winning, then you're in the 2,000 to 2,200, and then if you're world class, you're finally up around 2,600, 2,700.
Okay. Yeah, I thought that was worth getting in because to give people context for these, if they're not, if those numbers are not ones that
and that's an exponential scale too. That's our logarithmic scale. Yeah. It represents exponential growth. That each one is a sigma better than the other, and a sigma means that you're going to beat the other person 70% of the time.
Okay.
And so somebody 1,200 is going to be beat by somebody 1,400 70% of the time, and then 14 to 16 is another 70 over that.
Time, yeah.
And so When you go out and you play this, you know, and you rate it and all of this, you kind of think of it as kind of, well, numbers that you can just kind of increase, and you don't realize the vast difference between playing skill, that the difference between 1,200 and 2,600 mm-hmm. means, you know, how much better Bobby Fischer is than me. You know, you just work for that next notch and the next notch, and you don't realize that you're climbing a molehill before Everest.
Yeah, there certainly is quite a difference. I actually played Bobby Fischer once in a simultaneous, and I didn't last that long. So I know that feeling, yeah. I guess your take is that the programs of that era were 1,200, 1,300 kinds of things?
They were probably slightly better than that. Computers were expanding quickly there, and the Northwestern program was the perennial mm-hmm. champion all during that era. And they broke like 1,800 towards mm-hmm. the end of that era, towards the late 70s, probably middle 70s. They won a Class B tournament, which is limited 1,800. They actually came in first at somewhere in the valley here. Mm-hmm.
So, okay, so you were running around with basically a pure software solution at this point. Running what, PDP-11s?
PDP-11, yeah.
Okay, so then how did you get going on doing Bell and getting into hardware as well, software?
It just came naturally that you find out that, you know, you profile, try to make this thing go better. You know, the algorithm is where you start off with the current board position, you try all the moves, and then you turn the board around and let the opponent play. For each of those moves, he plays all his moves, and then for each of those you play. And so this grows exponentially, and you plot, all this stuff is in the literature, you plot how many ply you can look ahead.
A ply is?
A half a move.
Half a move,
where you turn the board around and play the same, play yourself. Turn the board around and play yourself for each of those. So there's 20 or so moves on a board, so two ply will be 400, and three ply will be, you know, bigger and bigger and bigger. You profile what you're doing, and you find all your time is in the mechanics of chess. It's not in the algorithms or the thinking or the evaluation. It's all mechanics, you know, finding the legal moves. And so the very first thing you think of is, you know, an accelerator to make those legal moves a lot faster. And you say, aha, one more ply, you know. And I made a little tiny chess move accelerator that essentially did what software does, is it finds a piece and then looks for blank squares, you know, wherever the piece would move, radiating out from that piece, and lays down those moves. And then what happens is it presents these moves to the software, and the software has to pull it out of the hardware. And then it's kind of hard to go into, but you have to sort those moves before you actually play them. You can't play them in the order, in some random order that they come out of the hardware. You must sort them. So the hardware generates these moves fairly fast. And then you pull them out meticulously and laboriously into software, and then you sort them. And by the time you do that, the hardware is swamped by the sort and the. So it did speed things up, but not by what you normally think of as a hardware solution. It sped it up by, you know, two or three, something like that, instead of 100, which you'd expect out of hardware. So that was the first solution.
Quick question here. So how many plies deep would your original software solution go? And then how did this give you, what, another ply?
No, it probably did nothing more. It was probably four ply with software and then four ply still with hardware. And that competed in exactly one tournament, which was the 1977 World Championships. Which was in Toronto, I believe. And I came in roughly center of the field, maybe a little higher. I was a point higher than center of the field. So it was a wash, you know, but it was fun. These tournaments in those days, especially, you'd sit across the table from somebody who, you know, who knows chess just like you do. And the computers would sit there and play, and you're bored. You know, you watch the game, but, you know, it doesn't take all that much time. And you'd talk about algorithms, and you'd talk about ideas on what you're going to do about chess. And then that would actually fuel you. You know, you play six or eight of these people over the course of 4 or 5 days. Then you go back home, kind of absorb everything you learned, and try it, you know, for the next year for the next tournament, and then come back, and it all happens again. So that's how it was sustaining.
Are there any particular people or that come to mind in terms of having interesting exchanges with?
Oh yeah, essentially all of them. Mm. Atkins and Slate were the perennial champions. They were running on the fastest machines. Mm. They were running on control data. Yes. 66 and 7600s, and they were sponsored by Control Data. And then Bob.
And which Hyatt, program was that?
They were chessx.y for two, you know, sure. 3.0, 4.0, 4.5, 4.6. Hyatt and Lauer from Hattiesburg, Mississippi. Were sponsored by Cray when mm-hmm. Cray came out, and they were the champions mm-hmm. for a while. Berliner is an amazing man. He won the human, the individual, world correspondence chess championship. Just an amazing feat. And he sat down and at one of these meetings told me what he went through personally to win this championship, and against whom, you know, against these, I mean, this is the epitome of chess, is the correspondence championship, and he was the best by far.
You might want to explain that, as not everyone knows what that is.
Correspondence chess is where you are given days instead of minutes to make your move, and you do it at home with open books and open chess boards, and you move the pieces. And when you make your move, you write it on a postcard and you send it to your opponent. Your opponent logs it when he gets it and starts his clock, I mean, you know, the calendar instead of a clock, and sends it back. And so you get so many moves in so many days. And you carry on simultaneous games. You know, you're playing the whole field at the same time. And then there's a lot of the strategy is that where you're playing, if you want to stagger your clock, you play, you know, you play one move and send it, come back. But if there's obvious replies and you want to dump your opponent without the ability to think during the postage time, what you do is you lay out a big, it's like a contract. If you move here, I move here. If you move here, I move here. If you move here. So you lay down six kind of force moves or the best moves and dump him right in a position that is coming, and he knows he's coming. And instead he gets 2 or 3 days per move to do it, rather than nearly double or triple that time if you count in the postage time, because there's just one postal exchange. So that kind of strategy, playing people's best lines, their own lines, the research involved, it was just a massive toll on his, you know, his personal life, his professional life. He took to do this. It became a full-time job, more than full-time job, you know, 20-hour a day kind of job for the duration of this tournament, which is several years.
Wow. Whew, yeah. That is hard, yes. Mm-hmm. So perhaps before we get into the further hardware work that happened, talk about the structure of the software that you were using at that point, in terms of things like opening book and middle game and end game. You know, what were its abilities in these areas?
It was really run-of-the-mill. All of the computer programs were roughly the same. There were a couple of outliers, a couple of people who tried to do real planning kind of things. But the other ones were progressively became strong enough that they never made a bad mistake. And all of the planning type of programs maybe played better and looked better, but they always made some horrible mm-hmm. mistake somewhere along mm-hmm. the game. You just have to make 20 moves in a row with no mistakes. And if you make one mistake, you know, you get your head handed to you. So they can play chess better probably, but they can't win games and win the tournaments better. Darwin pretty much culled those guys out. All of the other ones were brute force or semi-brute force. And what they would do is start at the opening position, play all the moves for each of those moves, play all the moves for each of those moves, play all the moves. And most of them, at first they played to a fixed depth and then evaluated. And then they started playing to varying depths, where they would play to some minimum depth and then extend based on what they found along those depths. You know, like if their king was in trouble, they'd move again, or if they're... But basically, they would never skip at very shallow depths any move. They looked at everything, and therefore they'd avoid the really bad mistakes. And then at the bottom they'd evaluate, and evaluation involved an exchange analysis on the, of what happened, and then turn back. And then there's this marvelous algorithm called alpha beta that is based upon the idea that if you find a move that beats, if it's you and I, all right, you make a bad move and I show it's bad by taking your queen. You put the queen on pre, I take it. I don't have to find the best way to take it. I don't have to find the best move against you. All I have to do is wipe that out and to the point where it looks worse than some other alternative that you have. And so as soon as I refute one of your moves, I don't have to find the best refutation. I can quit at that point. And if you sort the moves, this is what I was getting at earlier, if you sort the moves, you want to make the best move first so that your refutation comes, you know, statistically higher in the list, and then you don't look at the rest of them. And so typically, if there's a 35 moves on the board, very typical, one side makes 35 moves, it's on the offense and is trying to find the best move, and the one on the defense has to just prove that's a bad move. He makes one move, and then the offense makes 35 moves to try to count that. So it's the tree looks like 35 1 35 1 35 1, and so it grows as the exponential of the depth over 2 rather than the exponential of the depth. It means you look twice as far with this algorithm as you can without it. And it's just immensely powerful.
So when did that start to get widely used?
It was used before I got into chess. In history, if you look at the books, there are 3 or 4 people who invented it. Samuel says he invented it in his checkers program, but if you look at the records of the games he played, I doubt that very seriously. Simon and Shaw say they invented it. Knuth has a claim to some portion of it in writing about it, not in a real program. And there was another chess program that said they invented it. So, you know, it's sort of lost in history who actually invented it, or maybe it was invented more than once. But there's two forms of it. There's a so-called deep cutoff version and a shallow cutoff version, and I think that the two versions came about separately.
Okay, but it was widespread in use then in the 70s. Is that
yes, like, it yeah. was.
Okay,
yes.
Okay. So that had gotten in. I think that's certainly one of the things we've been interested in for the chess exhibit, was to show the power of such algorithms and why they do make a difference. So that's good to hear that extra commentary on it. Okay, so then after doing mostly software with a little bit of hardware, somewhere in there you really got going on doing Bell with some help from Joe Condon, I guess, and some
right.
other folks.
Yeah. Joe Condon and I teamed up, and we built a small chess machine, which is in a display case in the lobby of Bell Labs now, that is maybe a cubic foot. It had a LSI 11 in it, and three cards, which is about a square foot each. One card was the move generator that would generate the moves and sort them and play them. It had a micro machine that would actually play. It had another card that would evaluate the board, and then it had a third one which was made out of memory chips, 64K bit memory chips, that was the transposition table to like a big cache, so that when you found a position you've seen before, you can just cough up the answer instead of reevaluating it and cut off the search. That machine made its debut in the U.S. Championships in Washington, D.C. in 78. And it won them, essentially, for the first time, cutting off chess X.Y.'s dynasty.
Okay, and sort of what kind of depth of search?
It was searching about 8 ply.
8 ply at that point,
yeah.
Okay.
6 to 8.
Okay. All right. So then, where did you go from there?
We played it again the next year in I can't remember where. Minneapolis, and we tied for first. Because, of course, they were on monster general purpose computers that were getting faster all the time. And Joe and I then went off and designed another machine after that. So it played those two tournaments. The next one was about the size of a small refrigerator, you know, a hip-high for refrigerator. Was built on the exact same principles, but it was much more parallel. It had three sections. One section was four boards, which was move generation. One section was evaluation, which was four more boards. There was one more board that was microcode, ran the whole thing. It was conducted by a PDB 11, an LSI 11, and it had commercial memory at this point, 1 megabyte, big monster of transposition memory that was run by the microcontroller. It was probably 100 times faster than the other one. It ran about 160,000 positions per second. Typical software ran about 6,000 positions per second. That's on a fast machine.
Okay, so back to the machine, yes.
Anyway, I took this off to its very first, it went to the chess club a couple of times, and it actually became the Westfield Chess Club champ. It was clearly playing in the master level area. We had probably 4 or 5 masters and 1 or 2 senior masters, and then a couple of visiting IMs, international masters, at this chess club. It was a very strong local chess club. And Belle had been since the early 70s, Belle was a member and a frequent sponsor and things. Let me digress for a second. There was a hostility about computers and chess and humans and chess, and you know, in the same tournament, and whether they cheated or not, and it was all a big philosophical question. Some people were just adamant, and mostly they were just apprehensive and afraid. And so I made it very, very slow inroads into the chess club and built on relationships and things like that. Sponsored, you know, tournaments, and always refused prizes, always moved the prizes down if I ever won prizes. And then played friendly games and played simultaneous exhibitions with the computer. And then pass out, you know, analysis that the computer would print during its game with the people. So it built it in, so it was part of the structure of the club. And then as new people came in, it was just there, and they always played it and everything. Everybody played it, while other people would go into a club and demand that they had the right in this and generate lots of bad feelings. If you have a chess machine like this or a program and you're trying to find out how well you're doing, the best way to do that is to take it in, play it, get it rated. And the rating is a nice number. It says how well you're doing. Mm-hmm. And if you haven't got a nice, friendly place to do that, first off, you're getting rating points from Fear Factor, which I don't think is fair. And second, you're generating more heat than necessary in doing it. So anyway, I had this local chess club, Westfield Chess Club, that I cultivated as a resource to play, and I went nearly every week for 10 years there. Mm.
And so how did its ratings improve in that period from then?
From 1,200 to 22-something. Mm-hmm. In a period of about 6 years. Mm. So anyway, this monster machine went to the World Championship in Linz, Austria, L-I-N-Z. That was...
And which year was that? That was...
80.
1980, yeah, okay.
And that was, I don't know, that was a lot of fun. It was too important to actually take the machine, although it was portable enough to do that. So we left it at home and called it up by phone, which most of the computers were big mainframes, were also called up by phone. And after 4 rounds, there was a tie. 5 rounds, there was a tie. And so they ran out of money for phones after that. And so what they did is they had both the winners, co-winners, were in the United States. One was Bell, and one was Chaos was their name. And had them call each other up in the United States, and then once every 5 or 6 moves, they'd call us and read the moves off to us, and we'd pretend like it was real time. So anyway, and Bell won that. Won the playoff. These are Swiss tournaments, a very short Swiss tournament. So actually who wins is remarkably close to the notion of who I thought was the strongest, even though they're pretty random events because of the very short tournaments and one loss and you're out kind of thing.
Okay, so then I guess where did things go from there? Because yeah, that Bell was certainly a force in chess for a number of years.
Yeah, I played it in a bunch of tournaments, a bunch of exhibitions. I took it to Moscow. That was that famous...
The famous, infamous trip. Yes, yes. Since you mentioned it, why don't you describe this?
This is a hard thing to describe. I got invited by Botvinnik, in case you don't know who Botvinnik was. He was a world champion, the grandfather of chess. He was actually the span across the war. He was a strong player before the war and a strong player after the war. Well, all the other world champions and big, real strong players were either pre-war or post-war. He spanned it. He was kind of the inventor of the Soviet school of chess and the Soviet dominance of chess. He's instituted a set of camps for finding chess talent and building it and everything. He's just the Soviet chess player, the old guy. He invited, mostly invited my computer, because he had a chess program and he was having trouble funding it, and it was largely regarded as a computer chess was largely regarded as a fraud, and he wanted to generate some publicity that this really was working and there really was for his own personal benefit, for his own fallout. And I was allowed to go along with my computer. So I show up at Moscow, and I had arranged, I brought the computer out, all packaged, to be in the hold of the plane that I was going in, and made sure, made all the arrangements and all everything, so that when I arrived, it would be there, and I could take it out and have, it wasn't separately shipped. So I had to go out to Kennedy twice, once to package it the day before and everything, and then once to go myself. Then, so I landed and I go to the, while they're undoing this this plane, and it's not there. Don't know why. It's just not there. It disappeared. And so we make a trace on it, and the trace comes back in a few hours, and I get it back in the hotel, and they say it missed the plane. It'll be on the next plane. So I tell my sponsors, and we go out to the airport, and we meet the next plane, and wait, and it doesn't come off, and don't know what happened. And we call, and they say, we don't understand. It should have been on that. It must be on the next one. So we meet the next one. It wasn't on the next one. It's like 2 days now. And there's a massive schedule. I'm there for a week, and there's a massive schedule of where I'm supposed to take this machine every day. And then there's like little pieces of touristy stuff between these chess schedules. And they keep pushing the schedule back and making it all tourist, so I'm touristing. And at some point I get a call from Joe Condon from Bell Labs, and he says, I hand carried a bunch of spare parts for this machine. I had a disk and a CPU and a whole bunch of spare parts. And Joe called me up and said, "Don't bring the spare parts back. Throw them away." And I said, "Why?" He says, "Because you're probably going to be arrested when you get back in the United States." I said, "Oh, good." He says, "What for?" "And for smuggling computers into Russia." And I said, "Oh, God." So what happened? And what happened is that an ex-Bell Labs guard was working as a night guard at Kennedy and happened to notice that that a Bell Labs package that said computer on it was cordoned off by the security police, the feds from Washington. And that nobody at Kennedy, none of the local customs people were allowed to touch it. It was just, roped off. It was like another world, And he called up his friends in the guards department at Bell Labs and said, maybe you want to know about this. And that rippled around and finally got to Joe Condon, who found out that this thing was confiscated out of the hold. And what had happened is the day before I left, Ronald Reagan gave his famous hemorrhage of technology speech to Congress, saying we're just bleeding our lifeblood out to these commie, pinko bastards, and so the Customs Department, they just jump up and they run out to all the airports, and what do they see? They say computer, destination Moscow. They just grab it. They lock in a corner, and don't tell anybody about it. There's nothing. So, next day, I call a meeting of all my sponsors, there, and it was the most uncomfortable position I've ever been in my life. It was in the chess club, and it was a very long, dark, drapery laden, deep purple red, underlit room. It was with a table, an oak table probably this thick, that was maybe 10 yards long. And the head of the Soviet guy, his name is Krogius, he was a grandmaster, was at the far end, and I was at the far end. I'm sitting all alone, and he's got like four minions, clustered him, and then there's about 20 spare seats, and I'm sitting at the other end of the head of the table, and he says, I explained to him that it's not going to come, it's confiscated. And then he said something very, very strange. He said, Ayatollah Khomeini. I says, yeah, I've heard of him. I'm not a good friend. He says, well, Khomeini has outlawed chess in Iran because it's against God. And do you suppose Reagan did this to outlaw chess in the United States? And I said, I can just see the headlines now, So, no, I don't think so. I think this is some low-level custom guy who probably didn't even know how to play chess. And he says, oh, okay. And that was the end of this meeting, this meeting. And then I was a tourist, and they wouldn't talk to me. I was pariah, but I you can't leave. Except on the reservations are like forever. You have to have them months in advance to go in and out of there, and you don't change them. So I was there for another half a week as a complete pariah. These guys just didn't want to talk to me, and finally went home. And I stopped off in Germany and dumped all my spare parts at a friend. And then flew back to the United States. And after that, I tried to get the computer back. And you could go out to Kennedy, and it was there. But nobody knew who had it, what they wanted, what they were hoping for, what it was all about. And so we had this import-export company that kind of worked with Bell Labs for going to shows and things like that. And they worked full time on it, couldn't find anything about it. And so at one of the chess club meetings, this Westfield Chess Club, I was telling this story about how it's taken and you can't get it back. You don't know who wants it. You call and there's this telephone number on it. It says for information, call on the computer. And you call this number, and they take your name and address and say they'll call you back, and they don't. And that's it. That's all you can get out of these people, this telephone number. And so I relayed this story and the frustrations of trying to get this back. This was about 6 weeks after it was taken, still sitting at Kennedy. And one of the guys there worked part-time at one of these weekly throwaway magazines on Long Island. The ones that, you get, little local community newspaper. He says, you mind if I write this? And I said, no, go ahead, write it. It's true. And so he wrote it, and it came out in one of these magazines. And then a clipping service got it, and some guy from the Washington Post called me by way of this magazine. And I told him the whole story. And he says, well, let me look into it. And I said, well, good luck. You know, I've been looking for 6 weeks. I've been trying very hard for 6 weeks. And he said, so he hung up. And 15 minutes later, he called me back, and he knew who had it, what they wanted, everything about it. You know, he had contact. Somehow he figured it out, you know, from what I told him. And he says that they claim that Customs has it, and they claim that it can be used for weapons research. And I said, you know, there's no way it can be used. You know, maybe if you threw it out of a plane, it could kill somebody. And he says, can I quote you? I said, sure, I said it. You know. And so the next day, there was a Washington Post article, fairly large one, about this, with this quote about, you know, killing somebody by throwing it out of a plane. And the next day, it was picked up by nearly every newspaper source. You know, the day after that, the Customs called me. They finally called me. You know, I'm sure it had nothing to do with these newspaper articles. Made them look foolish. And they said, what is it worth? I said, technically, you're in violation of the Export Act. The HP terminal that I was taking with this to run the computer was on their list of bad things that you can't take overseas, right? And their list is so old. I mean, this was an obsolete, you know, terminal. You know, the computers were not on the list. You know, all the chips weren't on the list. But, you know, this lousy HP terminal was on the list. And they said, so technically you're in violation. And typically what has to be done is you have to pay a fine that's a percentage of the worth of the equipment. So how much is the equipment worth? And I didn't understand what he was saying, but you know, I said, the budget that, you know, we kept a budget for it, and it was $17,000 to build this thing. He says, well, you don't seem to understand. It was probably used parts now, right? And they probably weren't worth their full weight. And you must realize that we're gonna have to fine you a percentage of the cost. And I said, yeah, they were used. it's probably only worth $1,000. And so, okay, well, we have to charge you 50%, so a $500 fine, you know. And so Bell Labs sent them $500, and they sent the computer in. That happened in the next day. So suddenly it just all broke loose. And so anyway, that's the Moscow story.
Okay, so that's where the origin of the quote is. I had heard the quote, of course, but I had thought that it was earlier in the sequence, not at the end.
Right? What broke it loose. Otherwise, it would probably still be Kennedy.
Let me think, which year was that? That was?
Probably 82 or 3.
Okay.
83, I guess.
Okay.
It was June. While I was there, it was VE Day, which is a big, big holiday in Moscow because of the war. And it was later than our VE Day by one day because the news didn't travel. It was a day late getting there.
All right. Well, you seem to have lived through that experience with a good story out of it, anyway. So then after that, let's see. I think, as I recall, Bell won a number of additional times.
Years.
Yeah.
It sort of dominated. It had a hardware problem that I could never fix. That it was wire wrapped, and a batch of wires that we got were nicked. What they do is they pre-cut they're in lengths with pre-cut insulation on the ends, and their machine was ill-calibrated and actually nicked the wire when it stripped the wires. And so when you put it in a gun and wrap it on the post, it would stretch it. That's how wire wrap works, and it would break inside the insulation. And if you didn't notice it, if it didn't actually separate the wire, so it would cause an error, you'd have these nicked wires under stress on these posts. And they, if they failed, you could find them. But if they were intermittent, which one of them turned out to be, and I never found it, then it would sometimes run and sometimes not run. And when you chase it down, it would start to work. And it would be catastrophic during a game because it would fail in the middle of the game. So it stopped working around 85 or 6. It actually won, the last time it won was the 86 U.S. championship. It won 80, 81, 82, didn't win 83, and 86.
86, okay. So now, at that stage, how many plies was it going, and what kind of rating did it have?
It was going 8 full plies easily. The other one was probably going 6, and was easily master, probably 2300. I never worked for. Rating, you know, you can squeeze rating points out by studying your opponents and booking up and taking the latest, put a bunch of trap kind of stuff in. But I wanted to play, you know, just play nice solid chess, and so it was probably 2300.
And I think at some point I recall you talking about the ratings compared to compute power. And you had, I think, extrapolated forward about what kinds of compute power it would take to get certain improvements in ratings.
Yeah.
I can't remember when that was. It must have been early 80s or something.
Yeah, it was early 80s. Yeah. It was asymptotic, but it was in the high-rise part of the asymptote, so you can't really tell where it rolled over. But it would certainly in that era, you were gaining for every doubling of horsepower, you'd gain 100 points.
100 points. Okay.
And I came with some really fakey back of the envelope calculations that said at around 12 or 13 ply, you'd be world class. Maybe not. You'd compete for the world title. You may not win it, but you'd be comparable.
Be competent, okay. I mean, presumably the ratings, in some sense, get a little less accurate at the very top, I would think.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So it last won in 86, and then at that point, did you retire it, or were you using it internally for things? What were you doing with it then? There was a period, as I recall, when you were doing a lot of work on end games. Maybe it's worth talking about the end.
Okay, the end games. I did it under the name Bell, but I didn't really use any hardware for it. That was all software.
Okay. So why don't you talk about that some? Because I recall that's been an area where computers have certainly augmented our understanding of chess. Yeah.
It started. It's a very long story. It goes back. The first tournament I was in was in second tournament I was in was in San Diego in about 75. And in that tournament, David Levy, who's a famous chess personality, was the tournament director. And we were, after the games, we were in the bar talking. And he was saying that computers can't play end games, even simple end games, and they never will. And he says, I'm an expert in the rook and pawn against rook end game, and a computer will never play a rook and pawn against a rook end game. So I went to my room in the that evening, and I was calculating the numbers and came to the conclusion that this was doable, that you could solve that game. Absolutely solve it by a different mechanism, but not by normal computer chess, but by a different mechanism. You could just have the answer and look it up, that you make a table of everything that you're supposed to do. And I came back the next day and told him about it, and he says, no, it takes too many plies, you know, 50. And I said, it's ply independent, this is a different method, you know, it just, he says, so he just poo-pooed me, and I got sort of, angry is not the right word, but I got, you know, you know. So I went home, and I worked probably for, after that, 10 years on endgames from that one encounter, one evening after the bar. And so the method is to lay out a chessboard that has two kings on it, and then look for all the positions that the two kings can, all combinations of positions that the two kings can be there, and find which ones are mates. And, you know, surprise, you find none of them are mates, right? So then you put a king and a queen against a king, and you find all the mates in there. So then you have a list of all the mates in one. And then you build, instead of a move generator, you build an unmoved generator, where you find all the positions that can arise from that. And a move is like an unmove, except check is a little different. Uncapture is a very strange move. Some of the, you know, uncastling and stuff like that. So, but basically it's just a move generator with different rules. And so you find all the positions that you can force the mates that you found in the last pass into play. And then you do that again and again and again and again. And when you find no more, everything you didn't find is a draw. Mm. So you do it by exhaustive search, one ply at a time, back from the terminal positions, from the end positions. And it's called retrograde analysis. Mm. There's a lot of chess problems like this. And so I worked on it, and the computers just weren't big enough to really do. This was a data manipulation problem. It wasn't a computation problem. You just couldn't hold the answers. Mm. The biggest disk was like 5 megabytes at the time. Mm. And this was, each of these positions of three pieces had a king, and a thing were megabytes. And then you add another piece, and it becomes, you know, it gets bigger and bigger. And then when you add a pawn, which implies that it can promote, which implies that it can be any number. Anyway, I solved a bunch of these 3 and 4 piece endgames. And some of them turned out to be very, very tricky and actually overturned conventional wisdom.
Say some more about that.
the hardest one of the 4 piece endgames is king and queen against king and rook. And it's the conventional wisdom that the rook cowers like a chicken, and the queen comes over, eventually separates it, and takes it, checks and takes the rook. But the defense it comes up with is not cowering. It's very active and very proactive, and it kind of keeps the rook, it keeps the opponent king away from the your king by an empty square, an empty row. And no one's ever seen this defense before. So I played this at the local chess club against the Masters, and then I played it at the 77 World Championship against some very strong Canadian Masters. There was a U.S. Championship going on in Chicago at the Park Hotel. And a friend of mine was there playing. Called him, and he arranged and had a bunch of the real strong masters from the U.S. Championship, U.S. Open, play the computer simultaneously, queen against rook, play either the, you know, and it held them all to a draw. Mm. He couldn't win with a queen, and then he said, "Well, let's find a real strong grandmaster." And the U.S. champion at the time was Walter Brown. Mm. And a friend knew Walter and says, you know, you can't get him to play this. He'll think it's stupid. But if you bet him money, you know, he's a better. Then you got it. He's a fish.
human ego, yes, comes through for the machines.
So,
okay.
So we bet him $50. He couldn't win against queen against rook. And so we set up a date. And he had friends over, and he was gonna, you know, he allocated 30 minutes, you know, he was gonna just blow it away, you know, in 30 minutes. And you could, you know, he had people over to watch, and about halfway through, he kicked the people out, you know. The place went silent. He started going way over on time, but we didn't call him on time. And and then at some point, you know, we knew exactly how far we were to mate at every point. And we knew he wasn't going to win because, you know, it was going to take him more time than we had. And we said that the rules were 50 moves. He has to win on the 50th move or less. You know, computer chess, this is human rules, 50 moves.
Sure. That's the 50 moves with that either require a piece to be taken, right?
A piece are taken or a pawn to be moved, yep. But there's no pawns here. And he lost, and so he wanted a rematch, 50 more bucks. And I said, well, you know, I'll give you your 50 bucks back. I've made my point. You know? He says, no, 50 bucks. And so he, we gave him from the current, there are two best positions, or worst positions, whatever you call these things, maximal positions. And we gave him one and kept the other one a secret. And from the one we gave him perfect play to capture. And he went home and studied for a week on perfect play. And he's a studier, you know. And he studied, I think, the whole week. And the next week, this was a Saturday, the next Saturday, we set up again, and it was much more serious. And we played the second maximal position. And he attacked like, you know, like, and the computer, when it had equal moves, it would play him at random. Anyway, he said he wanted, he made some more conditions too. He, 50 moves, he wins. 50 to 55, it's a draw. And more than 55, some number like that. I can't remember the exact conditions, you know, lose. Anyway, he actually did it. First guy who did it over the board, did it in exactly 50 moves, right on the nose. Mm. One more move and it would have been a draw by the rules. And there's one point right around 18 moves to the win where it's like a wall that people just hit it and bounce. They just don't know how to cope with this defense. And the computer makes like two or three random moves, selections. And one of them turned into a repeating move, you know, where he could move the whole thing down a notch by doing a set of checks, so which wasn't optimal, but it was human. And that's how he got through the wall. So anyway, it was fun. It was written up in the Minnesota Chess Magazine called an article called Beer in Your Ear. Very, very well written.
So interesting. So it sounds like now what's the current state of endgames and how it sounds like we've gotten there with a lot of software.
Well, they grow exponentially with the number of pieces on the board, and so this was four pieces. Five pieces was done after that, and then right now the state of art is six, and six generates gigabytes of data, and every piece after that goes up by a factor of 64. Mm. So if you think that something, you've got to wait for the computer industry to Moore's Law to give you a 64 in order to try the next step, and we're between steps, we're between six and seven now.
Okay, working on some. Now, as I recall, unless I misheard this, I thought it at some stage did you not discover that there were cases, I guess, that it was impossible to do it in the 50 moves, it was still a win? Were there cases like that?
Yeah, there's tons and tons of them. The computer, the human rules were 50 moves to, but they didn't want to outlaw wins that were real wins. And there were like two known positions. One was two knights against a pawn. I think that might have been the only exception. Two knights against a pawn, which is the old, what's his name? I can't think of his name. A guy worked this out, human. Where two knights alone can't win because they can't mate a king without stalemating him first. Mm. And so that's why the king has a pawn, and the pawn is there just so that when you stalemate the king,
yeah.
the pawn moves, and then you go through
and there you go. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay.
Trotsky. This is the Trotsky position. Okay. And so that was an exception in the rule, where for that game, if you reached that game, you had 100 moves instead.
Oh, okay.
And the idea was that you got to, you know, demonstrate that you're going towards a solution, but they don't want to take the win away from you. If you are in fact winning in the Trotsky position, and you just don't have enough time, they don't want to take that away from you. So this was their theory, is that anything that was proved to be more than 50 moves, they'd add to the list of exceptions. And so I started publishing all these lists of exceptions. The list got longer and longer and longer, and they were all inhuman. I mean, they were just amazing solutions.
Right, you said they were inhuman.
These are just... They're just crazy. The hardest one is queen and pawn against queen. And people avoid this like the plague, because it's the queens are just wild on the board, and they're interpolated with million checks before every pawn move and stuff. In the six-piece endgames, there's one that this runs about. Depending on where the pawn is, this can run up to about 100 moves. So they put in a 150 move exception for a couple of these very long positions in queen and pawn against queen. And anyway, they started putting in more and more exceptions. Finally, they just canned it. And so they changed these rules about four times, adding the exceptions. And then they said, that's it. 50 moves if you can't win, tough. So they're back now to no exceptions, 50 moves.
Okay.
And the current record is in a it's king and two rooks against a king and a knight, a king, a rook, and a knight. And it's like 250 moves. I give you exact numbers sometimes, but
no, that's close. I just find that's an interesting interaction between the software finding these things in human play, right?
Yeah. Enough of these now are in the literature, or on the web, or there are databases around where you can go find the answers. That they become celebrities when they show up in a famous human game and the human doesn't do them right. Mm-hmm. Suddenly, everybody on the web's an expert, and they complete. You know, Fisher, you know, screwed this, and there was one of the Fisher-Spassky games that ended up in a draw was in fact a win, based on
one of these cases. Yeah. Interesting. So, let's see. I guess an interesting question looking back on this is, to what extent did the structure of your software change from, you know, when you had a program that was playing some, say, in the 1300s to Bell at the end? There's clearly the parts where you've replaced software by the sort of equivalent hardware, right? Were there other particular structural changes that went on?
Oh, the first ones, I didn't really understand alpha, beta.
And
it was kind of a mess, you know, and you'd compare things and quit, and, you know, it was just really not under control. But then as soon as I really boiled down the essence of alpha, beta, and got that, then they were all the same after that.
Mm-hmm.
They had little different extension rules, you know, where you'd search deeper and keep track of how deep you've gone and stuff.
Now, how about evaluation functions? Did that change over time?
they just got more and more. When you have a 1200 program, there are certain material dominates, and that's it. Mm-hmm. You know, hardly anything else. Anything else is, if it plays roughly 1200 points, as far as tactically goes, it just doesn't matter whether you understand weak square complexes and stuff. It just doesn't matter. So as the computer plays deeper, things it will just learn, like forks and pins and stuff like that, it will learn. But things that are just outside of its range, you know, you want to teach it, and you put those in the evaluation function. Search does a lot for, you know, it amplifies the evaluation function. And so subtle things mean more at bigger depths. And there's also another thing, that there's a randomness involved. There's a famous experiment. It's not well, not many people know it, but suppose you have a chess program that plays, you know, everything except the evaluation function. It's function F, okay? And you put in some terms like, you know, material's good, you know, whatever you want, all right? Suppose you replace that with a random number, just rand. Will that outplay a program that has some weak evaluation, real function, or zero? Will it outplay a program that has zero? If it has a big random number generator as opposed to a little random number generator, you know, will it outplay it? And the answer is yes. Random number generator is a good evaluation function. And the reason is it's amplified. If there's only one way to play, right, you're going to get a random number evaluation back, right? You're going to play, this guy must play this, this guy must play this, this guy must play this. This mm-hmm. Random number. So you have like 0 to 1, that's your random number, and you bring it back. You know, that's going to be your function at the end, right? So anyway, if you have this, a random number generator is in fact a good evaluation of the shape of the tree. Mm-hmm. And that if you have, there's various technical reasons, but if you have some real evaluation function, if you throw some little random number generator on, it'll make it better. It will take the shape of the tree in to the account of the position, okay. And it will give you more flexibility in the tree. You know, it's a way of breaking ties in certain cases. And that shows up in fact that a four-ply search can have like four coefficients, four patterns, whatever you call them. Four isn't good for deeper things because it'll find different ways to find those four. What you want to do is the deeper you go, you want more and more subtleties in your random number in your evaluation function. And so, yeah, I guess the question was, as you go deeper and deeper and deeper, you must keep up with a random with a valuation function.
Now, as I recall it, I think at some point, didn't you have instances of Bell playing itself or something like that? Or instances of the earlier software?
That was to get the curves that we talked about earlier about what a ply means. Mm-hmm. You'd have Bell playing at 4-ply against Bell at 5-ply. Mm-hmm. And 4 against 6, and 6 against 4 and 5. And then you pretend like these different bells at different plies are in a tournament, and you'd rate the tournament, and you'd get a rating per ply for each of the, and then you'd get this typical asymptotic thing in the range that we were doing was 100 points per ply.
Okay. Oh, that's where that came from. Okay. So actually, some of that brings me to one of the more meta questions in here, which is the brute force versus artificial intelligence thing. So you were clearly on one side of this. Perhaps it's worth talking about how you came to believe that was the right thing to do.
Because you can't afford to make a mistake. And the deeper you go, the more you can't. Plus, alpha beta is so good that it takes you one unit of time to evaluate one move, if you think is the best move, right? It takes you one more unit of time to, with that as a basis value in the alpha beta, the alpha value in the alpha beta search, it takes you one more unit of time to to prove that all the rest are less at the same depth. So, I mean, it's so, this algorithm's so dominating that it just doesn't make sense to try to do better than that, because once you have a good move and an evaluation, it's so much, so easy in computation to use that value to prove, you know, bounds proof on all the other moves that you don't have, and you never have to say you're sorry when you do that. So it's the truth is that there's a melding of these two ways now. The current method is to do massive extensions down the main lines and then search the with some different kinds of proof. There's these null move generators is the big algorithm now. That if in this exchange, this you know, inside the computer you're playing yourself, you know, you make these moves. And the idea is that if at some point you think you're doing okay, and so you just pass and let the opponent have a move without you doing anything. It's like testing for the position for a threat. And if he can't do anything, if he can't exceed this alpha value with two moves in a row, then he's got a lousy position. And so you don't have to search that one very deep, because you know with two moves in a row, the idea is that if you really took your move, he can't do better than that. Mm-hmm. If he can't do it with two moves in a row, he can't do it with you know, after your move, which is not true in these Zugzwang positions, but you try to avoid the pitfalls. And so this gives you a place where you can severely cut down. What you do is if you can do a null move and get away with it, then you don't search that to a big depth. Mm-hmm. If you do a null move and you don't get away with it, either he has a threat, then you search
you
that
to
the full
it.
Depth.
Yeah.
And so you can take and throw away most of these positions and search them at like 2-ply less. And so computers now, if they applied the horsepower to the today's horsepower to the algorithms of the 80s, they'd be doing 8 or 9-ply. That now these PCs are doing 10 and 12-ply with this null move threat analysis.
So that's interesting. That's yet another sort of algorithmic efficiency approach to this.
Yes.
Yeah. So, as I recall, once upon a time, right, chess was viewed as sort of the great AI thing, right? But that seemed to have died off fairly early in the chess playing game. Is that fair, or is that
no? No. It was always touted as the Drosophila, I guess. So that was the word they always used. It's the Drosophila of AI. And the you know, Ijkai and all of those still, they talk about the computer chess, you know, being waged over there in brute force, but from afar, they just look at the results. They're getting better, they're getting better, they're getting better, as proof that AI is working without looking at what they're doing. And as soon as it became very clear that they're just brute force, plus they're getting very good, and that no AI program ever competed, they slowly drop the Drosophila. Now they're talking about Go.
Go, okay.
Where brute force doesn't work on Go.
Have you ever tried the Go turf at all?
No, I never got into the game. I guess you have to wire your brain at an early age to, you know, certainly understand the, I mean,
the rules,
you know,
are simple.
It's
yes.
a trivial game, you know, in some
some yes.
But no, I never got in into the game, and I tried to, you know, read and understand the game, but this was, you know, my 20s, and I think it's too late then.
So, sort of finishing up here, any particular moments in these matches where there were surprises, either positive or negative, where Bell surprised you or the opponent surprised you? Any particular things that stand out? Or?
Oh, yeah. Almost every match, nearly every game, had some monster surprise. When it was flaky and it would just throw away a piece in the middle of, you know, it had rare. It was an attacker. I mean, I tuned the evaluation function to, you know, weigh king safety really high, you know, and it would just go for the throat. It was, I love the way it played, and I did it mostly, you know, for entertainment, not for results. And so it would be, you know, just tearing this guy's king apart, you know, just going in there and laying waste and then suddenly drop a piece, you know, and announce it at a mate. You know, looking, where's the mate? You know, those are horrible. And then the missed opportunities, you know, where you upgrade a program or hardware that's like maybe 10 or 100 times faster. And then you go look at the tournament that the previous program played, and you say, "Oh no, how did I miss that?" And then there's a game. I'll show it to you if there's a chessboard around. But it's a 20 move game that was just spectacular that it played. This is in Washington, D.C. It beat. Because I was paired, I was a dark horse here, you know, and I was paired in the center. And so the first round I was paired against, you know, in the Swiss tournaments, yeah. I was paired against the top player. I was played with chessx.y and I beat him first round. And the second round I was paired against the second player and beat him. And the third round I beat somebody in the middle and had won the tournament. They'd all lost and couldn't catch up. And so I'd won the tournament after the fourth round. After the fourth round, I'd already won the tournament. I had another game to go. I was more than a point ahead. And this last game I played, and it was just it was one of the most beautiful games I've ever seen. And you know, to watch that on top of the, you know, coasting to a win, you know, watch it play this marvelous rooksack right out of the opening, where nobody saw it on the board. It was just beautiful. There was a move in it that was his move was pawn takes queen, my queen, which was a sack, discovering a check.
Okay.
And the reply was a double checkmate. It was, you know, blocked the check and delivered double checkmate. It was just, never seen anything like that on the board.
Interesting. Yeah, well, it is. I guess when I was watching all this, the thing that struck me was that the funny things that happened, where this was supposed to be artificial intelligence, but it was more partnership between human designers of chess programs and the programs, again, sometimes generating surprises or spending all this analysis of endgame to find the cases.
There's very the in-game stuff. Almost every program now that competes has those in-games just buried in their tables, so that if they run into them, they get the answer. They're actually rarely useful. You never run into the in-games in a real game.
Now, how is that? Usually you have an end game sooner or later, right?
No. Computer chess games are won in the middle game. they're rarely. I mean, not never, but rarely. Everybody has them because they think they have to have them, but they're not that useful. Opening book is useful, but unfortunately it can be used a weapon against you. If somebody knows your opening book, they can book against you and essentially win the game before you
get out of
before
book.
Your computer starts to play.
Okay.
And the these commercial programs, you know, the ones that sell at Christmas, you know, for it's a big feather to be the best of the commercial programs.
Sure, of course, yes.
And of course, the opening books are commercially available. So somebody who comes out a week later has an anti-book to the everything on the market. So anybody who goes and plays these two programs, A beats B 100% of the time.
Because
B has A's book. There's all of this stuff. Well, in real play, except to not fall into opening book traps. Opening books are not that useful. Mm-hmm. If you want to play real high level chess, mm-hmm. you need to have them. Mm-hmm. You got to save the time. Mm-hmm. They save it a lot of time, and they avoid a lot of
traps
yeah. and stuff. And they can direct you into the kind of positions that computers are good at. Mm-hmm. The computers are still good at the wide open tactical positions, and they're pretty lousy at block positions.
Mm-hmm.
So the combination of saving time, avoiding traps, and steering the game into the types of positions a computer's good at make them really good for, like Kasparov against Deep Blue, those mm-hmm, kind of mm-hmm. positions.
Hmm. So let's see. Okay, so and sort of the current state of the world then, I don't know, what sort of size of opening book do the typical programs have?
I don't know. I honestly don't know.
Well, what size did you have when you
mine was monstrous. I had essentially all ECL.
Okay.
and the reason is because I would play everybody's favorite opening. If you open E4, because that's your book, mm-hmm. book says E4, you've wasted maybe 80% of your book. By also having D4 mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. And C4 mm-hmm. and Knight F3 in there, right? That don't transpose, and that's exactly the same proportion that alpha beta cuts off.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? If you're mm-hmm. going to make this move, you don't have to analyze
sure,
the other
sure.
moves. And so I had an opening book during that era. It was an order of magnitude larger than the next. But mainly because it had all the openings and I really loved to mix it up and especially in simuls I'd play random openings.
Oh, okay. Huh. How many different ones would be in the mix of the random opening if you had white?
Let's
see, it's not that many.
I'd tell it to make a random choice. Maybe 20 or 30 places.
Okay.
Yeah, or real early in the book. So
okay.
Okay. It rarely played the same game twice or near it.
Oh, interesting.
It,
okay.
Near it.
Okay.
And then I put the weird stuff in. I put counter gambits and king gambit. And just weird stuff. Loved it.
Yeah. So now how much storage did that take at that point?
Not much at all.
Not generally, yeah.
If you store it by tree, it takes a byte per move.
Okay.
But I stored it by position and hashed into the positions, and it took maybe 50 bytes per position.
Okay.
It would also on one game it would always convert every position it stored into white.
Mm-hmm.
It would rotate if it was black to move. Every position in the book was white to move.
Okay. Right? Okay.
And so, if I had a position that was black to move, I'd rotate the board and flip mm-hmm. it, mm-hmm. flip the colors, and then look it up white to move. And there's many instances in the opening books where the same position occurs: black to
okay.
move, white to move.
Okay.
Where essentially somebody's white's lost half a move.
Okay. Yeah.
And if you follow the analysis, it's completely different. And the reason is because there's a psychological point of view that you're white, you attack.
Oh, okay.
Or you're
okay.
black,
oh,
you
I
defend.
See. Oh,
and
I
so
see.
You'd have the exact same position where the moves where one side would be attacking and the other side would be defending, and the same, the same side would attack and the same side would defend. And once in a game, I actually transposed into a black side of a Sicilian that turned into a white side of a English, and started attacking us. It was beautiful.
Okay, so I guess the question is, are there any other particular things that come to mind about this whole experience that are worth talking about, or any other particular high points that we haven't caught already, sort of as closing words?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. I don't know. It was a, you know, I miss those days, and I miss the tournaments, and I miss the people. Mm. I don't know if you know it, Valvo passed away.
No, I hadn't heard that.
Last year, the end of last year, not long ago at all. It was just fun. I don't know, you know, serious chess is pretty serious.
Yes.
And you know, you can't talk, and you know, nothing. But these chess tournaments, it's nothing but talking, you know, and you know, the chess is almost on the side. It's almost like a symposium with some little chess on the side. And that has actually changed. It's much more cutthroat now. Mm. And they hide their algorithms, and the programmers don't talk. They typically have heavy commercial concerns. And you saw that changing in the 80s, and now it's really changed. I miss the way it used to be. It was almost like a fraternity or something. Mm. It was, you know, people who knew. I don't know how to describe it.
Well, I think that'll make an interesting center point then for actually some of this for the chess exhibit, because there's certainly a phase in there when a lot of knowledge comes out, and the exact sort of thing you're talking about was happening.
So. Well, there was. I have a. Maybe I shouldn't say this, but there, in a Washington tournament, this guy, chess programmer, Fred Schwartz, got up from the table to go pee, all right? And he doesn't come back, 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 and everyone's worried about it. So we go look in the bathroom, and he's in his bathroom in his underwear. And what happened? He's got robbed at gunpoint in downtown Washington. And the guy took all of his clothes and his money and ran out.
Well, with that, so there are probably more surprises than one can possibly describe. But I think that's an interesting one. Okay, any other last words on this?
No.
You're done? Okay. Hey, thank you, sir.
John.